A lot of you guys have probably heard of this guy.
What is your, is homosexuality a sin in your eyes?
Yes, I've always believed, Pierce, the scripture shows that it's a sin.
His name is Joel Osteen. He's a pastor of a megachurch called Lakewood Church in Houston, Texas. If you're unfamiliar with my channel, I like to talk about destructive cults, Christian extremists, megachurch pastors, that kind of thing. But interestingly enough, I've never covered Joel Osteen. I knew about him. I just have no idea how he slipped under my radar for so long. He's famous for two main things. One, in 2017, Hurricane Harvey rammed into Texas and caused massive destruction. Osteen is famous for keeping his doors closed to hurricane victims after being asked to open it to people who needed help. And two, he's famous for having Kanye on as a guest not long ago. Kanye, of all people. Anyways, as it turns out, the Hurricane Harvey thing was a misleading criticism, and we'll get into why in a minute. We're also going to talk about who the guy is, his history, preaching style, and more. Let's get into it. So who is this guy exactly? He was born in March of 1963 in Houston, Texas, to John Osteen and Dolores Pilgrim Osteen. His dad was a pastor all the way up until he died of a heart attack in 1999. Joel Osteen studied radio and television communications at Oral Roberts University in Tulsa, Oklahoma, though he didn't graduate. He came back to work with his dad at the church, producing TV episodes of the sermons for 17 years, from 1982 to 1999 when his dad died. That's when he took over.
Do you ever stop and think, wow, how did this happen?
I do. I do stop and think about that often, especially periods when I never planned on doing this. I mean, 12 years ago, I was running camera at my dad's church, doing the production, things like that. I never thought I'd get out in front of people. I never wanted to do it. I like being behind the scenes. But you know what? When my dad died, I felt like down in here I was supposed to step up and pastor the church. Never ministered in public before and never dreamed it would grow. But here we are.
He definitely has a unique and distinct preaching style. He's more of a self-help guru than a fire and brimstone televangelist. According to Osteen, he focuses more on the goodness of God than on sin. Here's a quote from an interview on CBN. Quote, "When I grew up, the devil was a reason why I had a headache, or the devil was a reason why I got mad today. We always blamed the devil. I think today when I say the enemy, I like to make it broader. Sometimes the enemy can be our own thoughts. We've trained ourselves the wrong way, or the enemy can be our own lack of discipline. Some people preach about hell like you're already going there, and to me the gospel means good news. I'd rather say God is a God of mercy, so I think the people already know what they're doing wrong, and I certainly believe in hell, but to me, when I see thousands of people before me, it just doesn't come out of me to say, you guys are terrible and you're going to hell. I'd rather say that God is a God of mercy. You've got to live an obedient life, but for every mistake you've made, there's mercy there, and I believe we can do better." End quote. That's a far cry from the fire and brimstone types like Kenneth Copeland. It's something I can respect, actually, surprisingly. But Osteen comes with his own set of problems. First of all, he believes in something like the law of attraction, though I don't think he's specifically endorsed the law of attraction doctrine specifically. Here's a definition if you haven't heard of it before. Quote, "In the New Thought spiritual movement, the law of attraction is a doctrine that positive or negative thoughts bring positive or negative experiences into a person's life." End quote. Basically, you can control reality around you by thinking positive things. If you believe that you're a celebrity, then you'll become a celebrity. It isn't just about having a positive attitude. It actually gets supernatural. They think you can make anything happen if you think hard enough. And that's where prosperity gospel comes into play. He primes his audience by teaching about law of attraction type ideas, and then he finishes them off by teaching prosperity gospel. The idea that if you donate to him, then good things will happen. God will take care of you if you send him money. It's the same scumbag tactic that Kenneth Copeland, Jesse Duplantis, and others use to weasel money out of people.
I honestly believe this, that the reason why Jesus hadn't come is because people are not giving the way God told them to give. You see what I'm saying? Wow. I mean, when you understand it, you can speed up the time.
Tell them they're planting a seed by sending in $10, and that seed money will grow and return to them tenfold if they live up to God's standards. If they don't receive the money, it's their fault. It's a clever little scam when you think about it. I'm trying to be mostly unbiased about this, but I have to be straight with you. Megachurch pastors creep me out. I do have a bias here. The stuff they do to people makes my skin crawl. It's wrong. I would have fewer complaints about this guy if he didn't preach the prosperity gospel. Don't get me wrong, I'd still have complaints. He still believes all the same traditional stuff that comes with being an evangelical megachurch pastor.
What is your, is homosexuality a sin in your eyes?
Yes, I've always believed, Pierce, the scripture shows that it's a sin. But, you know, I'm not one of those that are out there to bash homosexuals and tell them that they're terrible people and all that. I mean, there are other sins in the Bible, too. I think sometimes the church, and I don't mean this critically, but we focus on one issue or two issues, and there's plenty of other ones. So I don't believe his homosexuality is God's best for a person's life. I mean, sin means to miss the mark.
You see civil partnerships being sanctioned. You think that's wrong?
Well, presumably. Yeah, I think it's wrong, but I'm not going to bash those people. I'm not going to be against those people. They're good people. I say it's wrong because that's what the Scripture says. And you know what? I choose to live my life by what I read in the Scripture.
Granted, that's a better message than some pastors. People like Steven Anderson or his generals like Tommy McMurtry are absolute monsters when it comes to LGBT issues.
We know there have always been assholes. We know they have always been around. We've read the book of Genesis, okay? Nobody's saying they're never around, but there was a time when society, when our country saw them for what they were, and they put them in their place 6 feet under. And unfortunately, we have forgotten that in our country.
Osteen's approach is obviously more tame, though he clearly still holds some monstrous views. At least he isn't calling for their deaths. Either way, I have no respect for people who hold these views, even if they're nonviolent. It's still wrong. He doesn't talk about politics terribly often, but on a few rare occasions, he's thrown his hat in the ring. He went on Fox News in 2008 during the Republican presidential primary race to talk about Mitt Romney and whether or not Mormons are Christians. He said he thinks they are, but he hasn't studied the religion much. He also expressed his support for Israel in a 2011 interview, which leads me to believe he probably buys into a lot of the same end time stuff that other televangelists believe. You don't have to buy into those conspiracies to be pro-Israel, but you have to be pro-Israel if you buy into those conspiracies. Check out this clip of televangelist Pat Robertson explaining why Israel is so important to Christians and predicting that Armageddon will take place sometime between 1980 and 1982.
Why is Israel so important? I mean, what is it about this little bitty country that sits right down in the middle of, like, you know, you can't hardly find it, can't even put the name on it, had to put it on the ocean. What makes it so important?
Now, God has called this in the Bible the navel of the earth. Now, a navel is sort of like the place where a child is attached to its mother, and God used this as the place where he entered into human history. And that's why all the world, the United Nations and the nations of the earth, one day are going to come and move against Israel. I'd give it 1982, but date setting is dangerous. I'd say within the next couple of years, we're going to see a war there. The next major war to be fought in the world is going to be right here.
Ever wonder why evangelicals and Republicans support Israel so fervently? It has nothing to do with the people of Israel. In fact, U.S. evangelicals like Pat Robertson actually believe that Israel is going to be destroyed in Armageddon. There's a silver lining behind every mushroom cloud for them. They're waiting for God to destroy it with bated breath. They just need Israel to exist as a country so it can be destroyed again. They believe that's what the Bible prophesies will happen in the end. If you thought they actually gave a shit about the Jewish people, you were mistaken. Evangelicals usually spread conspiracies about them too, despite their support for Israel. Jewish people have been the target of an insane number of conspiracy theories. Like, almost every conspiracy has some weird route back to Israel. Anyways, that's why I feel it's a safe assumption to think Joel Osteen's support for Israel is less than genuine. Before we continue, I wanted to mention something. If you like what I do and you want to see me continue to do it, you can support me in a few ways. First, there's Patreon. That's probably the best way. But if you want to get something back for your support, you can check out my Teespring. Or you can check out my Etsy shop. I sell all kinds of cool stuff on there, including these signs. If you want to keep Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons from knocking on your door, put one of these signs out front. They're not afraid of much, except apostates. They'll hesitate before knocking when they realize you're an apostate. I sell a bunch of other stuff on there too, including game and controller stands for every system from the original Nintendo to the PlayStation 4, so give it a look. You might find something you like. Now, about these two big controversies. The first one, about the hurricane, has largely been considered unfair. So what happened? In August 2017, Hurricane Harvey hit Houston, Texas, the home of Lakewood Church. It did untold damage to the city. Homes destroyed, businesses closed. It was a terrible mess. And guess what? The church doors stayed locked to hurricane refugees, despite the fact that it's actually a gigantic renovated stadium that could house thousands of people. Osteen refused to open the doors. News outlets picked up on this and started blasting him for it, saying this is the exact type of situation that churches should help with. It picked up steam and turned into a national scandal. The reason I say it's an unfair controversy is because there were posts on the church's social media accounts that said the church was inaccessible due to flooding, and even some some convincing pictures to go along with it. The Category 4 hurricane struck on August 17, 2017, and the devastation and preliminary cleanup didn't really stop until September 2nd, 2 weeks later. The social media posts about the inaccessibility of the church were posted on August 17th, the day the storm struck, before the media frenzy laid into them. So I'm giving them a pass on it. I don't feel the criticisms were fair. The second major attention the church received was when Kanye West came to the program to talk about loving Jesus. This was during Kanye's big conversion to Christianity, right when he was trying to promote his new album, Jesus is King. And he had some real strange shit to say. Why he picked Joel Osteen instead of a full-blown fire and brimstone preacher is beyond me. Fire and brimstone seems way more up Kanye's alley, based on what he said in the past. I don't want to get hit with a copyright strike, so I'll just give you a quote from Kanye when he went on the show. He said, quote, "All that arrogance and confidence and cockiness that y'all saw me use before, God is now using that for him," end quote. He also said, quote, "We all end up participating in the devil's playground, whether it's spirits that get advertised to us all the time. Alcohol is, they call it a spirit, so we get constant advertisement for spirits," end quote. Okay, that's a weird one. He's equivocating. Spirits is a term used to describe alcohol, and it's also a term used to describe supernatural beings. He's saying they're the same thing, I guess? Here's another quote from Kanye. "It's like the devil stole all the good producers. The devil stole all the good musicians, all the good artists, all the good designers, all the good business people, and said, you gotta come over and work for me. And now the trend, the shift, is gonna change. Jesus has won the victory, because now, I told you about my arrogance and cockiness already, now the greatest artist that God has ever created is now working for him," end quote. Wow, dude, Kanye is something else. I think Eminem sold more albums than Kanye, or they're at least really close. Not to mention the Biebs. Don't even get me started on the Biebs, we'll be here all day. So needless to say, Kanye's appearance on Osteen was bizarre. It didn't really fit in with Osteen's brand at all. Kanye really is a fire and brimstone kind of person, and Osteen isn't. There was one other controversy Osteen faced recently. One criticism I feel is perfectly fair to levy. The fact that he took millions in PPP money during the pandemic. Check this clip out. This is from 2011.
Some of the stats on your business empire are quite extraordinary. JoelOsteen.com is one of the top streaming sites in the world with 500,000 viewers. On iTunes, you get 4 million downloads a month to your podcasts. You have 1 million daily requests for your emailed daily inspirational message. I mean, this is the stuff of empires. I mean, you make vast sums of money. I'm right in thinking, you think the church takes in $80 million a year, but all of that gets plowed back into the church. Is that right?
That's correct.
But on the books, which sell by the squillion, you keep all the cash.
Well, we give. We're big givers, I'll promise you that. But
takers as well?
Sure.
Keep some of it?
We do.
Would you have any problem ethically?
It's like when you have to pay the light bill, you know.
Exactly, yeah. But I mean, you're like multimillionaires, aren't you?
Well, we don't have any problem. I don't think God has any problem with you being blessed. It's where your heart is.
The church is filthy rich, and it has been for a long time. And on top of that, they don't pay a dime in taxes. Not one dime. And a lot of their revenue comes from sources that don't require much overhead. Sure, they have to pay the camera crew, the video podcast editors, the managers, the cleaning crew and whoever else, but how was this church adversely affected by the pandemic? Did they lose all their revenue when it hit? Of course not. In fact, they probably made even more money when it hit. Guess what people were doing during the pandemic? Sitting at home watching TV. At least a lot more were than before. If anything, the pandemic only improved his already exploding business. I'm not going to mention book sales here because he said he keeps the money from book sales and the PPP loan was for the church, not for him. Assuming he's being honest about where his money comes from and how it's spent, which I have no reason to assume, but I'm being charitable, the book sales are irrelevant to the conversation. Considering how gigantic this church is and how much money they bring in every year, and the fact that one of their main sources of funding was pretty much unaffected, I'm calling foul. So just how much money did he get from the government? $4.4 million. That is insane. You know, as a business owner, I actually had the option of getting a PPP loan too. But I didn't for the same reason David Pakman didn't. Because I was surviving. I was okay. But you know who decided to take it anyways? Kanye did. And so did Joel Osteen. I find it fascinating to watch pastors try to justify vast amounts of money to their audience.
But I mean, you're like multimillionaires, aren't you?
Well, we don't have any problem. I don't think God has any problem with you being blessed. It's where your heart is.
Jesus specifically says, and I quote, "It is easier for a camel to fit through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. That's pretty specific. It doesn't get clearer than that. So it's interesting to watch him completely ignore that verse from the Bible, and in the same interview say this.
What is your, is homosexuality a sin in your eyes?
Yes, I've always believed, Pierce, the scripture shows that it's a sin. I think it's wrong, but I'm not going to bash those people. I'm not going to be against those people. They're good people. I say it's wrong because that's what the scripture says. And you know what? I choose to live my life by what I read in the scripture.
Fascinating little departure from reality there. He accepts the verses that he likes and rejects the ones he doesn't. So basically just like every other televangelist on the planet. Overall, I think there are more harmful preachers than Joel Osteen, but he's still a televangelist. He's still anti-LGBT. He still preaches prosperity gospel, separating gullible fools from their money since 1999. He's still filthy rich and taking advantage of the people beneath him by getting forgivable loans from the government when it's questionable whether they needed it or not. Anyways, that's all I've got for you. Thanks for watching, guys.